Thank you, Brother Parker. It's a privilege to be here. I'm sorry that I was a little late, but very serious case of sickness just behind the curtain. And I was ministering to the little baby. And so glad to be here again tonight, and I trust that I won't keep you like I did last evening. I kept you so long, and I went home, and I kind of felt, or went to my motel, and kind of felt bad about when I seen what time it was. I was speaking here for about an hour and 45 minutes. And of course, that's a short one for me. The other day I spoke 6 hours. See, if a fella knows a whole lot, he don't have to talk so long. But when you don't know so much, you just have to fill in, I guess. And I just wait on him. And when I feel like if he gives me something to say, well, then I say it. And I just kind of have stumbled along until then. I was trying to speak last night about reasonings. Not when anything reasons against God's Word. I don't mean reason, just any reasoning, because Paul reasoned with the people. In trouble today, people just take anything that comes along and don't reason it out with the Scripture, but when it's reasoning against God's Word, then stay away from it. That's the aim. But when it's reasoning with God's Word, that's God. See, that's right, the two reasonings. So we believe in reasoning with the Word. Believe that the Word is right. Now you cannot scientifically prove the Word, because and you never will, because it's so contrary to science. If it's scientifically proven, then it isn't any more faith. You've got to have faith, and faith is contrary to scientific proving. So you must believe it. Not prove it, believe it. That's the idea. Some time ago I was talking to a man as a Toronto, Canada, and we was having a great meeting there. The Lord was blessing in such a marvelous way, and I was across Toronto. Now I'll take that back. I forget the names of the place in Canada. We were having the meeting, and I'll pick it up in a few minutes. Travel so much that I can't think of the names of the place sometimes. And it's right across from Detroit. What's the name? Windsor, correctly. Windsor, Ontario. And there was had a television set sitting on the street, some kind of a screen of type. And there was a cowboy there playing, strumming on the guitar over broadcasting from the United States. And a man come out and was talking to me. He said, "Like sell you that?" I said, "No, sir. We're just passing." I said, "I don't believe I want it." And he said, "Well, I'll make it to you real cheap." And I thought I'd explain it to him. I said, "I'm a tourist." I said, "Oh," I said, "you're just passing through, I suppose." I said, "No, I'm down here in a motel." I said, "I'm just here for a few days." He said, "You're not with that meeting over there?" I said, "Yes, sir. That's right." He said, "I don't want to hurt your feelings, but said you're listening to a quack." And I said, "Oh." I said, "That's sir." I said, "You think so?" And he said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "I do." And I said, "Well, why would you draw an opinion of that?" And he said, "Well, because the man's talking about something that he doesn't know nothing about." And I said, "What do you mean?" Well, he said, for instance, last night, that soldier there that had been in the army and laying on this cot and is supposed to be paralyzed, he said, "I got up and walked around there." So that was just as an act. So that man knew the man all the time. Said, "He's just laying there acting like that." I said, "Why didn't you go to the man that was on the cot and check up and see who he was? Where he come from? You were real deeply interested, don't you think you should have done that?" He said, "Well, here's the whole thing." He said, "I ain't trying to discourage you." I said, "Oh, you won't." So he said, I think that I believe in science. I said, "So do I." He said, well, anything that cannot be scientifically proven is not right. I said, I don't mean to be different, but I just say that's vice versa. Anything, he said, is not real. And I said, anything that can be scientifically proved is not real. I said, it's the things that cannot be scientifically proved that's lasting and real. Oh, he said, that's wrong. And he said, look here what science has done. First, he said this. He said, well, he said, I do not believe. And I said, well, I want to ask you something. Are you a married man? He said, I am. I said, you love your wife? He said, I certainly do. I said, so am I. I appreciate that. But am I doing this? Oh, all right now. I'm sorry. I can't tell it here, you see. So they said, anything you cannot scientifically prove is wrong. I said, well, now you love your wife different than any other woman? Yeah, I said, what is that? Got children? What makes them children different from any other children? He went ahead talking just a few moments and he said, well, he said, now for instance this. He said, you see, there's not a war around it anywhere. I said, that's right. And there's a great thing. I said, now here it is, that man's over in the United States, and without a war or anything connected to it, to the United States, through a wave, some kind of electronic wave or whatever it is, brings that man's picture here just as perfect and reflects it on there. He said, he just said he couldn't understand how that discernment said, I think it's just a put up piece of business. I said, oh. So I said, now, that's not a put up piece of business. You wouldn't say that, I said, because it's absolutely, there's a wave coming through here, and we're taught that that same picture's coming right through us. And that the message and that songs and everything's going right through us. But then it's hitting a certain crystal or something in there that's or a tube that can reflect that picture and the picture of the man that's traveling through the ether waves of the air. We don't know where it comes from. It just, we know where it comes from, but I said, we can't see it. And it passes through and reflects it there. I said, that's way God. I said, that's how that fellow knows those things. I said, see, God, see, sends the ether wave down, and I said, it might pass through thousands and millions of people until it comes to that spot, and then it reflects it. And so he said, he said, that's all right, but said, look, see, we've got a sanding station. We've got a sanding station that sands that. I said, so have we. We got a sanding station.
Amen.
That's right. A sanding station and a receiving station.
Amen.
So he's still our Heavenly Father, isn't he? We love him because that he loved us first and sent Jesus Christ that he might die in our stead, that we might be the righteousness of God through Christ. So glad. Those visions sometimes are, they kind of stumble people, they don't understand. Sometimes people think it just goes on only right here in the meeting. Oh my, this is the little part of it. It's out there is where it really happens. Today I was sitting in the room. We had usually Friday's a fast day for me. I don't eat on sometimes Tuesdays and Fridays, so sometime in the afternoon, just a little, that's not a regular fast, that's just a couple days a week to fast. So, long fast comes in more days when the Lord puts it upon you. But that's just in respects and honor of God's great memorial to us, the fasting, a command. And so after 3 o'clock, usually I have a little something light. Somebody told me where you could buy a little steak down the road here for about 90 cents, just about right, for you to eat. In preaching and these things, you have to keep kind of emptied up. So we were planning on going down there, and my son and my nephew wondered why we didn't go down there, but we turned and went to another restaurant. And then sitting in there, I noticed in a few moments we were talking, and some people were there. There's always grand to meet my friends, you know, and talk with them. And so I shook hands with some of the folk, In a few moments, two ladies came in. The Holy Spirit said, the one with the white hat on. Moved around, never seen him in my life. And strange, when one woman was going to sit like this, she turned around and was facing right at me. That's grace. Knowing just nothing happens by chance. So she's looking right at me. Strange, my own son who stood with me here on the platform for years. But he asked me a question, something about the great millennium or something. And I said, Billy, I don't understand those things. I said, I just got my ideas about them. I said, I don't teach them because I might be a million miles wrong. And see, I said, I just got my ideas. And he said, well, I'd like to know about this and something other. And then all of a sudden, he didn't catch it. And he doesn't know what I'm saying about me saying this now if he's present. But if Charlie and Billy's close, did you notice Charlie? All at once, Billy changed to grace right quick about the grace of God keeping. See, he didn't realize at that minute the Lord had given me contact with that woman's spirit. And there she was. She wasn't too sure it was me because she had only seen me last evening. I thought, Lord, I see the woman, the condition she's in, and what's happened. Maybe she's with the meeting. I knew she needed help. Just then, after we finished our dinner, some sweet little sister from down somewhere come along and paid for my dinner. So then she and her husband and children, so then I got up to go pay for the dinner, and I guess Billy and Charlie noticed I let them go on because I knew the lady was coming somewhere because I knew she was behind me. A few moments she spoke to me. There I was able to tell the lady just what had happened, what had taken place, and not by chance, but that was the beginning for her healing. Long years ago, she was a woman, I suppose, around close to 60 or something. And in the time of menopause, she'd gotten extremely nervous and she wasn't able to pull from it. And she said, I only heard you once to come from way away. As last night, she said, that remark you made about breaking through that sound barrier so he could get free. She said, all day I've struggled at that sound barrier. I said, don't struggle no more. It's over now.
Amen.
Go through it. And I said, the sound barrier is the barrier between faith and disbelief. When you get beyond that unbelief of a shadow of doubt, you're free. And see, there's nothing. And the lady had, during that time, she got how menopause sometime, especially either coming in or going out, makes the people so nervous. And she had never been able to pull through that. The woman thinks sometimes that she's lost and she goes off. And she's a Pentecostal believer, I think so, but the lady had wearing makeup, short hair, everything, but the reason she had did that, she was trying to shake from that, see? Trying to shake away from that horrible feelings. And we just got to talking about, see, that's how, Billy, don't know now, and I'm saying this to Charlie, that was what grace, the reason you were feeling that, Billy talking like a blue streak, you know, grace, how comes it, this, and how comes that, and how, you know, so and so. I said, it's a grace of God. Those who he foreknew, he called. Those who he called, he justified. Those who he justified, he's glorified already. It's all God. And that was it. And she don't have to worry about that. She was trying to shake from that thing. She'd go out and she'd do this and do that, trying to get away from it. But the day that poor little woman struck the key, she'd get all right now. And she may be here tonight. I don't know how. She might have went home. But she might be here yet tonight in the meeting. But it just goes to show that how the grace of God will do things. It's exceedingly abundantly above all that we could do or think, isn't it? Wonderful. Now tomorrow morning is breakfast. And I asked Brother Parker if I was to speak at that breakfast, and trying to get away from it, but he said, no, and I was supposed to say a few words, and then tomorrow night I want to try, the Lord willing, to preach, bring a little message, and I don't think I'll try again like last night, because I felt real bad sitting here before teachers and renowned teachers who knows theologians like Dr. Lee Vail and all these other brethren here who I know, my graduates and so forth, that have studied the Bible and trained in that, and me stand here trying to bring a message of that type. I thought I'd come to pray for Brother Parker's sick children. So I better stay on that line. So we are here to help. Now tonight, I want to try to speak and read some scripture so that it won't take me too long, about 30 minutes or something. Then I want to pray for you sick people tonight. Just believe. Now anybody knows that human beings can't do these things. It's impossible. Amen. See, it's got to be the Spirit of God. And so the only thing we can do is pray for the sick. I can't heal anyone because you're already healed. If anybody tells you that they can heal you, that's wrong. See, if anybody tells you they can save you, that's wrong. You're all saved anyhow. See, the only thing you have to do is just accept it. You accept what Jesus did for you. He was wounded for your transgressions, with his stripes you were healed. You were healed. It's already past tense. The only thing you have to do is accept what he done for you. That's all. And you're under the blood, every one of you, or God would destroy the whole thing. You're still under the blood as long as there's a bloody sacrifice laying there for our sins. And then one day when you leave this world without accepting that sacrifice, then you stand for your own sins. And you're condemned, you already, you see. So you can't stand. And your healing is just, God makes such a beautiful way. See, faith cometh by hearing. Preach divine healing. Believe it. Accept it. That, if that would be me, that's the way I'd do it. If you couldn't believe my word, all right. And you'd be the same way by anyone else, but not God. After he sends his word, then he puts in the church different gifts and things just to try to get it to the people. He's so loving and full of kindness. Let us turn now in the book of St. Matthew, a Gospel of St. Matthew, the 15th chapter, 21st to the 28th verse. St. Matthew's the 15th chapter, the 21st to the 28th verse. Listen closely to the reading of the Word. Then Jesus went thence, and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast, and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with a devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, Truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Let us just bow our heads now while we talk to the author of this word. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are now approaching thy holy sanctuary in the name of the Lord Jesus. And it's all sufficient, all that we have need, because he said, if you ask the Father anything in my name, I'll do it. Therefore, we cannot come in our own name or the name of a church or any congregation or any nation or race. We just come simply in the name of the Lord Jesus. And we know that you'll hear us because he said you would. And we're not asking tonight to stand at the throne of thy judgment. For we would be condemned, but we are asking to stand at the throne of mercy, to which we all seek refuge. Now, Lord, I realize the tremendous weight of the meeting and how that it must have poured from you this virtue as you looked upon the multitudes of sick, lame, halt, blind. As you stood at the pool of Bethesda and seen that great multitude, yet there was just one man that you were led to. And you said you knew he'd been that way a long time, and you healed him or asked him to accept it. And then being questioned, you said, "Verily I say unto you, the Son can do nothing in himself, but what he sees the Father doing." Lord, won't you show us the will of God tonight for this sick, waiting multitude? We are waiting the moving of the water, that the sick might get in and be made whole. I pray thee, God, forgive our sin of unbelief. Long as we have been following thee, and we confess, Lord, that we are way short of the requirements as ministers and as Christians. So be merciful to us, O merciful God. And as a man cried one day with a boy with epilepsy, said, "Lord, help my unbelief." We cry to thee tonight, Lord, after we read the promises of this precious Bible and see what could be done, then we cry, "Help our unbelief." Send the presence of the Lord Jesus in our midst tonight as we speak on the Word. And may the Word become flesh in our spirits. Catch it. Believe it. May we see the returning, approaching of the Lord Jesus as He promised, as the days are drawing out now into minutes and hours, or maybe hours and minutes. And we don't know just how close we are, Lord, but we see things are getting, looking ripe. So help us tonight. We present the Word to you tonight, Father, that you'll bless it, get honor to thy name, to which name we asked it in the Lord Jesus, and for his glory. Amen. I would try to draw from this little text tonight, or this scripture, for just a few moments, on the subject, or a word called perseverance. I draw that from the verses that I have just read. Perseverance. It is to make a goal, be persistent. I like the word, and it very fitly to the church of this day, or it should be, that the church should be persevering. Man of all ages that has faith in what they're trying to achieve has been persevering. No matter what you're trying to do, you've got to believe in what you're doing. A man once said to me, a doctor, he said, "Oh, I believe, Brother Branham, if the people would believe that they could go out and touch that tree and would be healed, I believe it would happen." I said, but my precious brother, man can't have faith in touching that tree. Faith has got to be based on something. And therefore, when a person can base their faith upon the Word of God, then you can be persevering. Because it's the Word of God. As the old brother said, colored brother down the southern states, he said he would rather be standing on the Word than in heaven. And someone asked him why. He said, because both heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word shall not. So that's right. Standing on the Word. Then you can have something, not what someone else said, what some school taught, what some minister said, what some doctor said, but it's thus saith the law. Then you can hold on. And anybody doing anything, if they're trying to achieve something, they must first have faith to believe it. Like the father of our nation is called our first president, George Washington, just up the coast a little bit. When I was reading here a few years ago about Washington, I'd seen him where they had that coat that the bullets went through. And we're told that the night before Valley Forge, when he crossed the river, praying all night, till his thumb above his hips was wet, where he knelt in the snow. He was seeking the will of God, because the opposition looked great. The Delaware was full of ice. About half of the American soldiers had shoes on their feet. It looked like he was crippled, but he sought refuge in God. And the next day he crossed Valley Forge. He was persevering. Bullets went through his coat and never touched him. He was trying to achieve something. So he sought God and got the answer. Then he could be persevering. That's what we do. You must first find the will of God before you can do the will of God. You must first know what His will is in the matter. And then don't turn it loose. And as the lady said today, she was trying to get beyond that sound barrier. Then the plane just picks up speed and goes on unlimited when it passes the sound barrier. Well, when you can pray until you pass the doubt barrier, then you're running free. You can go on. And then there's nothing can bother you then, because you're running free. You're past the unbelief. It's done, been settled. It's all over. When you get the assurance in your heart that it's going to be that way, you're just as happy as if it had already happened. Amen. Or you says, perhaps a loaf of bread, if I was starving, and a loaf of bread would save my life, and I would ask for the bread, and some man would give me 25 cents, and that's the purchase price of a loaf of bread, I can be just as happy holding the 25 cents in my hand as I can with a loaf of bread. Because it's the purchasing power. Amen. Then I've got it. I haven't got the bread, but I got the purchasing power. Well, that's faith. When you can pray until you got the assurance. You can be just as happy if the cancer's gone. Shout just as loud, because you got the purchase power, the faith that moves the thing. Then you're persevering. No one can tell you anything different.
That's right.
Doesn't matter what anyone says then, you've done crossed over the sound barrier.
Yes.
You're free then. Purchasing them. And being persistent. Noah, as we talked on him last night or about him, when he heard the voice of God speak to him and told him of the oncoming judgment, after he heard the voice of God give the witness to him what was going to happen and instructed him on what to do, he was very perseverant. Scoffers had nothing. No matter how many ecclesiastics stood up and said, Noah, you're wrong.
Hallelujah.
He pressed right on. He built the ark anyhow.
Amen.
Scoffers could have come around by the thousands and said, look at the old fogey. Look at him. The science could have stood there and said, Noah, looky here, fella. We love you, but you've lost your mind. We've got an instrument here that can shoot all the way to the moon. And we can prove that there's no rain or water between here and there that would drown the earth. Look in this instrument. It'll prove it. Noah might have said something like this. I don't care what your instrument says. You're looking at that instrument. I'm looking to God and what He promised.
Hallelujah.
That sin depends on what you're looking at, where your faith is. Now, the instrument declares it. That's all the farther you can go if your faith is in the instrument. Like a precious old brother, I was called about 15 years ago to pray for a boy dying with this black diphtheria. He had heart trouble. And they took the cardiogram and it showed that his heart was way down. I forget what the beat was, but he was going. The old mother and dad called me from the meeting and they sat on the steps for 2 or 3 days and said, if you don't come. And I said, well, get someone. He said that. I said, God's got his man everywhere. He said, but Brother Branham, said, you don't understand. I said, can I explain it? I said, I'll try to understand it. And I said, I'm tired and it's not right for me to go one place if I cannot go another. He said, but I said, unless the Holy Spirit would tell me to go. He said, but look, he said, we've sat in that meeting for a week. Said, we know that it's impossible for our own people in our neighborhood has sat in that meeting of different denominational churches, and the Holy Spirit has told them exactly what to do and how to do it from the platform, and it's been exactly what the Spirit said. They said, Brother Branham, we know that you could not do that. That it has to come from God. He said, therefore, you'll come and pray for my boy. The old dad said, he'll get well. Well, he was persevering. Very persistent. So I got my coat and took off. Went to the hospital and the doctor met me and he said, I wouldn't bother him. Said the boy might die at any minute. And the doctor belonged to another denomination church. Because I questioned him, I said, but sir, the boy is dying. I said, are you a Christian? He said, he belonged to another church, a certain denomination. I said, well, if your priest would come and that boy belonged to the same denomination that you do, and that priest wanted to give him the last rites, would you let that priest go? He said, certainly. I said, well, if this father believes that just as much if I can pray for that boy, he'll get well, as you believe the boy be saved if the priest give him the last rites. I had to be a little persistent too. So he let me in. The little nurse turned up her little nose and went back. So we knelt across the bed. The boy's unconscious. So I put my hands up on the boy and prayed just a few words of prayer. And I said, Father God, I do not understand, but this poor old man is crying out. And he asked me to come here. And the only thing I know to do is ask you. And I said, I pray that you'll spare the boy's life in the name of the Lord Jesus, and got up. And the old father turned around to the mother, put his arms around her neck, and they began to hug one another and wipe the tears from their eyes and say, isn't it wonderful, mother? And I looked, and that little nurse turned her head and looked and said, think of it. Bob's going to be well. Oh, we praise the Lord, they said. And the little nurse, they reached across the boy and shut my hands and said, thank you, Brother Branham, for obeying the Lord to come pray the prayer of faith for our boy. I never said no more than a prayer. And then the nurse said, sir, I don't believe you understand. He said, oh, yes, I do. Said, you claim you love the boy. Said, certainly we love the boy. Well, said, you see, she said, how can you act like that when the boy is dying? Said, now, in all medical history, when this certain thing, I don't know what it was, instrument, goes down that low, the boy cannot pump back again. And said, you see, the boy could die at any minute. His heart's only beating, I forget what his respiration is, very bad. And his heart was so bad, he had open valves and everything in it. And one of the valves was blocked or something, and said, he's unconscious now. He's even too weak to know anything. And said, then you can stand there and laugh and carry on like that. She didn't know what kind of carrying on that was. And say, act like that in your son dying. And the old gentleman, I'll never forget him. He turned and put his hand as a father up on the little lady's shoulders of about 18 years old. Little Snickle Fritz, you know, little Annie. And said, listen, honey. Said, you know, you are looking at that instrument. See? And said, that's all you know about. But said, I'm looking to a promise in the Word of God. Said, my boy is going to live. Boy, he said, the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and that's been prayed over my boy. Well, that's about 15 years ago. The boy's married and got two children. See, the persistency that he will believe no matter what instrument says anything.
Amen.
His faith wasn't in the instrument, it was in God's
Amen.
Promise.
Amen.
Noah, after he had heard the promise of God, he could be persistent, be perseverant. Moses, he had known intellectually by his godly mother, our beloved sister Josephel. He had heard her teaching in the intellectual manner how that his life had been spared from the crocodiles and how that God had made him a proper child and he was born for a deliverer. And how that Miriam, his sister, the prophetess, had followed him down to the bathing beach where Pharaoh's daughter was bathing. And how that God had brought him right up and nurtured him right in the palace of Pharaoh, and how he was going to deliver the children. Now, intellectually, he knew that. But you see, the first little mistake. Oh, don't miss it, church. You might know it from a word standpoint. You might know that the Bible said the prayer of faith shall save the sick. But you pray until God says the prayer of faith saves you. That's the difference. Moses knew intellectually that he was the deliverer. But when he thought the children of God would understand him when he slew the Egyptian, the first little rumor come up, he wasn't persevering at all. Just before it even got to Pharaoh, he took far the desert. Because he wasn't persevering. He wasn't too sure. He just known it from the word standpoint, the promise. But one day, he saw a bush that was afire. And it was burning, and it did not consume. So Moses went up the mountainside, and sitting back in that bush was that big pillar of fire that was to lead him the rest of his days. And in this pillar of fire spoke out a voice, I have seen the afflictions of my people. I've heard their groanings. And I remember my promise to Abraham. And I'm come down to deliver him. I'll go down there. Now talk about persevering. He walked right up in the face of Pharaoh. Said, let him go. Why? He had talked face to face with God till he had his commission. I think a minister, brethren, today would just not take it from an intellectual standpoint, but would find him a place on the backside of the desert on those sacred sands where Satan cannot place his dirty feet of unbelief and stay there until a message comes from God and position you, places you in the ministry. Then all the devils out of torment could not shake you from it. You know you're called. I think each Christian ought to do that. Before you come out and confess the Holy Ghost, confess that you have the baptism, there ought to be such a personal contact with God until all the intellectuals in the world could explain it from you. You know you've been there. You've had the witness. You know it so. That's a requirement. Jesus told the disciples, you wait, you know the intellectual part, you know the word, but you wait up there at the city of Jerusalem until you're endued with power from on high. Then they knew. Oh my, how little David, way back on the backside of the desert, little ruddy stoop-shouldered fella, herding these sheep out there for his father. One day a bear come in and got a lamb and he took off after him and took his little slingshot and killed the bear. And then again, a lion come in and got one. And he run out with the kid. And the little David, that was his father's sheep, and he took after him with the little slingshot. Not with a magnum rifle now. With a slingshot, with a rock in it. But his trust was in God. He slung the rock, struck the lion, knocked him down, and when the lion rose up, he slew him. Brought the sheep back. He was persistent because, he had a charge for his father's sheep. I think that ought to be the feeling of every clergyman. We got a charge from God. For the father's sheep. The old devil of sickness has struck among you Christians. He's trying to take you out. I, having no education, I know nothing about medicine, but the only thing I got is this little slingshot of prayer. I'm coming after you tonight. Want to bring you back. He promised that prayer of faith shall save the sick. Maybe the great intellectual, the great scientific medicines and things might laugh at it. I don't know nothing about that. As David, when he tried to take up a sword and put on Saul's ecclesiastical jacket, it didn't fit him.
Hallelujah.
Never does fit a real man of God.
Amen.
But he picked up, he said, let me go with what I've proven. That's the only thing I know, Christians, is to go with what I've proven to be truth. That's God's word. His words cannot come after his sick children. Let's bring them back.
There's shady green pastures and still waters. Good health. Strength. Little old Samson standing out there and caught up as we spoke of him the other night. The Philistines all around him, he had nothing but the jawbone of a mule. But when he could reach back and feel those seven little locks, he was very persistent. Shamgar. Many people never read of him in the Bible. He's one of the judges of Israel. Just one little paragraph wrote of him in the whole Bible. But when he was standing there after his harvest is over, his little children looked thin and poor. His wife maybe in the sleeves out of her dress. The Philistines would come right in and take everything they had as soon as he got all worked up. Got up to a good place and the Philistines would come in and take it away from him. So about time he got all his grain thrashed out in the barn and thought, well, maybe we can live and I can sell a little of it and get some little dresses for my girls and some shoes for my boy. Maybe be able to get a little cheap dress for the wife this year. He heard something, pulled back the barn door window and looked out there, the barn door rather looked out. Here come 1,000 Philistines. Armor, spears, swords, trained men. Tromp, up, right up the highway. There they'd pack away his grain. He stood there. Now he wasn't a fighter. He was a farmer. He didn't even have a sword, as far as we know. But he happened to remember, I'm a Jew. I'm circumcised. I'm a child of God. I've got a right. I've got access to the same God of David. I've got access to the same God of Moses. I've got access to the same God of Daniel. And the Spirit come upon him and he grabbed that ox goad and went out there and was persistent. And he slew 1,000 Philistines with an ox goad, a stick, what they punched the ox with.
Glory.
Slew 1,000 Philistines.
Hallelujah.
I was one time going into a stadium where I was to preach. And there was a great field of people, many thousands waiting. And I read a little something over that stadium. It always is a football stadium. It always encouraged me. There's a little sign there that said, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, but the size of the fight in the dog. So I think that's a whole lot of it.
Amen.
It's get a lot of real Christian come at it. Persistency. God promised it in its mind.
Yes, amen.
Right. John the Baptist is very persistent. They'd say maybe Caiaphas or some of the priests would come out and say, here's a Reverend Dr. PhD so-and-so. Don't you think he fits the Messiah? John said, it's not him. Brought another one. Here's a good man. What about him? That's not him. For he knew when he saw that dove descending from heaven, that would be him.
Yeah.
Then he was persistent. Oh, it's so much in the Bible to talk about. I never get to it. Let's get to the Greek woman. First place, she was a Greek. She wasn't a Jew. She's a Gentile. But she had heard of the fame of Jesus. She had heard of the critics also, how they criticized him. But she didn't pay attention to the critics. She was listening at the fame. She being a Greek, you know, you always got something to hinder, but you know, somehow or another, faith finds a source that people don't see. Faith finds its source. People don't see that. So it must have been this little woman that faith had found a source. The Word of God, the Bible said in Hebrews 4:12, is a sword. It's a sword. Cutting the mire, the bone, to the sunder, to the spirit, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. That's what the Word is. That's the reason Jesus could discern what was in the people's thinking, because He was the Word. And if the Word abides in you, and then it is in you, it's the Word. that goes out and discerns. And there's only one thing that can handle that word. It isn't an education, I'll assure you that. Faith is the only thing that can yield that sort of faith. As I said the other night, faith in God's Word will cut a hole through any difficulty. But you got to believe it. She had many hindrances. She did herself, but her faith didn't have any hindrances. No, faith don't have any hindrances. Faith just believes it. It don't have a hindrance at all. You're already past the sound barrier, as the lady was talking of. Faith don't have a hindrance. You might have it, but your faith doesn't have it. Your faith has no hindrances at all. They might have said to her, "You are Greek. You shouldn't go over there. That's a Jew. That's a Jew that they're claiming all these things about. You're Greek." But you see, they're trying to have a race barrier there. But faith don't know a race barrier. Doesn't know it at all. No. Because she might have thought this. If he is who I believe he is, he's God. And if he's God, he's the creator of every creature.
Amen.
If he's God at all, he's God of the whole creation. And if he isn't God of the whole creation, then he isn't God. That's a good way to look at it.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, no matter if she was a Greek, she was still persistent. She had perseverance. Then somebody might have come up with this old proverb, you know, they still have it today. The days of miracles is past. There is no such a thing. But no matter how many hollered at her, the days of miracles is past, she still was persistent. It might have been for them who believed it, but not for her. Something had already happened inside that let her know that it wasn't past. And until you get past that barrier, you'll never do no good. You've got to come past that barrier. God was, but isn't now. He's still God if he ever was God. And if he is the same God today, he never was God. See? That's it. It's man lost his faith, not God lost his power. God went back on his promise. This man went back on the promise.
Amen.
To believe. She was still persevering. If the days of miracles was past for all of them, it wasn't for her. Why? She'd struck a past that sound barrier. She got a hold of something. Something had struck her. Well, there's always another group to a little lady like that. Some of them might have said, "You know what? Your husband is a businessman. He belongs to the big church over on this side. And if you go down there to that group, your husband will leave you." Now, that's a great big barrier to pass. But I tell you, if you ever get a hold of faith like she did, that won't make any difference.
Amen. Hallelujah.
That didn't make any difference to her.
Amen.
Husband or no husband.
Amen.
She was on her road to meet Jesus.
Hallelujah.
She was persevering. And then there might have been the group that always stands around and says, "But wait a minute. If you go down there, Lydia, or what her name was, you know, you'll be the laughing stock of our nation because you know there's no such a thing down there. And you know that's just a Jewish fable. They've had all that kind of stuff, but we've heard about it, but it's nothing but just a proverb, a song that they sang." You know, they still got that group.
Yes. Yeah.
So, but when she got to that group, she'd be the laughing stock. And so forth. She was very perseverant. She went right on past them. All right. Then there come the ministerial group. Oh my, that's a bad one to pass. Now looky here, I've called her Lydia. I hope there's not a Lydia here, but it might be all right. I hope you had the same faith she had. So then, when Lydia got to the ministerial association, they said, "One thing to it. You know you're a member up here of our church. And that's a Pentecostal, or some kind of a group down there, you know. Anyhow," I said, "if you go down there, we are going to give you your church record. Your letter. We're going to take you right off the boat. We cannot come back to the church anymore. We're just going to send you away, and you'll be a laughing stock. Your husband will put you away in divorcement, and he'll marry a better looking woman than you are. And all these things, but that didn't stop her a bit. Church letter and nothing else didn't stop her.
Hallelujah.
Why? She had heard. Faith cometh by hearing. Hearing of the Word of God. She was persevering. She cried it right on through every barrier. Now, she arrives at Jesus. Now she thought it's all over now. That's the way some people think when they get the Holy Ghost, it's all over. It's just beginning.
Amen.
That's when you need to be persevering.
Hallelujah.
When you arrive. When she arrived at Jesus, Jesus said, give her a real hard shaking. I believe he knew she's coming.
Amen. Hallelujah.
So when she arrived, he turned around to her and let her know that he wasn't sent to her race. Oh my, what a letdown that would have been. Oh, but what did it do? That didn't stop her a bit. Not at all. Still, she called him Son of David. Of course, the Gentile has no hold on Christ for the name of Son of David. No, no. See, the Son of David was under the kingship, and Christ is the King of the Jews. But to the church, he's not the King. He is the Lord.
Amen.
He's the husband. As Sarah called Abraham her Lord. He's Lord of the church, but King of the Jewish race. So when she worshipped him and said, Lord, help me. Jesus said, but you know, it's not meet for me to take the children's bread and cast it to you dogs. Oh my. If that would have been a modern Pentecostal, she'd have turned that little nose up and said, I'll never go to a meeting like that again. Why? They don't have the hope that she had.
That's right.
She had the hope. She had heard and faith to call it. She had a reason. She had a need. And she just wasn't going to turn loose. Right. I like that. Yes, sir. Still she held on. Although she was called a dog. And a race that was lower than dogs. Said, I'm not sent to your race. I'm only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And she said, Lord, help me. He said, it's not meet for me to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Oh, my. She wasn't a hotbed plant to have to be babied. No, no. No, no. She wasn't a hotbed plant had to be babied. She wasn't a modern hybrid, so-called believer of the crop today.
Amen.
She had a hold of something. Not, well, I'm Methodist and I don't have to take that. Bless God, I belong to the assemblies. I belong to the Church of God. I don't have to take that. No, no. That's a hybrid type. You're bred into some organization. But a real, true, thoroughbred Christian's born to the Word of God and hold on. No matter what takes place. Anything that seems to be dumb to me is a mule. A mule don't know where he come from. He's not mule or he's not horse. He's a mix between a mule and a horse. He's not gentle, he's mean. He's low down. You wait all his life to get kicky just before he dies. You can call him and just stick them big ears up. Honk, honk. He doesn't know. That's right. He's hybrid. That's what's the matter at the church today. Too many high-bred so-called Christians. Right?
Amen.
They stick their ears up and say, oh, the days of miracles is past. Oh, you don't know whether you're a Christian or a sinner. You don't know whether you're a believer or an unbeliever. High-bred. Anything's hybrid is off the real main beaten road. We ought to have a little time talk on the original seed. See where it comes from. Hybrid. Don't know where it belongs. Don't know who his papa was, who his mama was, or nothing. No, he don't know he has no pedigree. He can't have a pedigree. He can never breed himself back. That's what's the matter at the churches today. They can't breed themselves back. They're hybrid. They don't know whether it belongs to God or some denomination.
Amen.
Only thing they can produce is a member, not a Christian. Maybe I oughtn't have said that if it's already said. Right! He don't know what he belongs to. He just knows he's Methodist, Baptist, or Pentecostal. That's all he knows. But oh, how beautiful is a thoroughbred. Oh my. He can tell you who his pappy was, his mammy was, his grandpappy, grandmammy, and great-grandmammy, and all the way back. He knows he's gentle, kind. You talk to him, he listens. Put his head on your shoulder, he's full of love. Why? He's thoroughbred. So is a thoroughbred Christian that's born of the Spirit of God. They don't go into any denominational argument. They know who their father is. They know where they come from. They know where the Spirit comes from. They know who they're born of. They don't argue your creeds. You can talk to them about love, about divine healing. All these things because they're born of God. Persistent, I should say. You don't have to beat them. They'll pull a load anyhow.
Sure.
Oh, my. How wonderful. Hybrid Christians. That's the cop today. Not her. No, sir. Watch. When Jesus said, I'm not sent to your race, giving her a test. She had an awful time getting to him. But when she got to him, then she had a disappointment. I'm not sent to your race. But she said, Lord, help me. He said, it's not meet for me to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Listen to this. Lord, that's true. Oh, my. Faith will always admit the word right.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. True, Lord. But I only want crumbs. That ain't a modern believer today. You'll come right down and do it the way I want you to, or I just won't receive it. That's the way Naaman was, trying to get rid of his leprosy. But you have to take it the way he brings it.
Yeah.
And when faith gets a hold of it, you'll go on with it.
Amen.
Yes, she's only hunting crumbs. Remember, this woman had never seen a miracle. She was a Greek. But she believed it anyhow. She's like the harlot Rahab. The harlot Rahab, when she heard, when she hid the spies, she was a Gentile, an outcast, a prostitute. But she heard. She didn't say, you bring Joshua up here and let me take a look at him. Let me see how tall, how handsome he is, how he combs his hair, how he grooms himself, how big he is, how big her shoulders. She didn't care what he looked like. She said, I've heard what God did for you.
Amen.
There you are. I don't care what Joshua looks like. I don't care where he's got a PhD or LLD or has got nothing. I know God's with you and I want protection.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I don't care whether they call them holy rollers, Pentecostals, fanatics, full gospel, whatever it is. I want God. I want his grace. I want his power. I want his love. I want his forgiveness. I don't care what you have to be called. I don't have to see this, that, or the other. Whether he's big or little or whatever he is, I just want to see him. I want to have his grace and mercy with me. That's what we need. Watch. This woman had the right approach to God's gift. How much difference it was to them Pharisees? How much was it to them Jews or rulers? Said, we would see a miracle from you. Oh, the ecclesiastical side. But this poor little ignorant Gentile said, this Lord, I'm just wanting the crumbs. Said, the dogs do eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. That's all I'm asking for. She didn't say, you have to come down to my house and lay your hands on my child. She didn't say, if you'll come down and speak in another language I can learn, tell me all about it, I'll believe it. She said, I only want the crumbs. Just the offals. That's all I'm looking for. See, she had the right approach. She had the right approach to God's gift. She is the first Gentile that Jesus ever done a miracle on. First Gentile. Faith always admits the words right, and faith always acts humble. Faith always admits the word right and always acts humble. Look at Martha and Mary. When little Martha had been made fun of so much or been talked about being so much about keeping the house clean, but when Lazarus died, she went to him. Look how persistent she was. Perseverant. She had to pass through all the critics that said, where is that holy roller preacher that was around here? Claimed he loved your brother so. See? Jesus knew the Father had told him, go away and wait till Lazarus dies and we'll bring you back. Because he said so. He said he didn't do nothing until he seen the Father show him first. That's right. So he went away and they sent for him and he didn't come. I imagine she got laughed at then. Where is he? Uh-huh, he run. Then sent again and he run again. Went to another city. Then finally he turned and said to his disciples, Lazarus sleepeth. Said, well, he's doing well. Said, he's dead, and for your sake, I'm glad I wasn't there. But I'll go and wake him. Well, little Martha didn't hear him say that. Here she come, persistent. She said, Lord, if thou would have been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, whatever you ask God, God will give it to you. I like that. Oh, I love that. Even now. Even now. You might say, Brother Branham, the doctor told me, but even now. I've been sick for 40 years, but even now, Lord. Oh, my. I've been seeking the Holy Ghost for a long time, but even now, Lord. While I'm in your presence. Whatever you ask God, God will give it. And he turned with not very much encouragement. See, he tries you. See how persistent you are. Don't give up. And if faith really gets a hold, it won't give up.
Amen.
Said, even now, Lord, whatever you ask God, God will give it to you. Yes. Jesus turned and said, yes, Martha. Said, your brother shall rise in the resurrection. He will rise at the last day. Said, yea, Lord, he's a good boy. I know he was a good boy. All that I believe. Jesus said, I am the resurrection life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Whosoever liveth and believeth me shall never die. Believest thou this? What did that get to her? Now she had a right to upbraid him and say, why didn't you come? I called you. I left my church. I left my organization. I left my friends. I quit the card party. I didn't go at the bunco game no more. I left it every bit. I come believing in you. Remember, the Holy Spirit hadn't come yet now. Teach him. But I said, I left everything and followed you. And when I needed you, you didn't come. When I sent, you ignored me and went on. I sent again and you ignored me. Looked like she could have had an argument with him, but she forgot all about it. She wanted to get to him.
Amen.
That's the reason she got what she asked for. Like the Shunammite woman before Elijah. She was persistent. She come up and fell down at his feet. And she said, Elijah said, after he found out what her trouble was, he told Gehazi, he said, take my staff. Go lay it up on the baby. And he girded up his loins and went on, but she was persistent. Her faith wasn't in the staff, it was in the prophet. And she said, as the Lord God lives and your soul never dies, I'll not leave you. She was persistent. He couldn't get away from it. So he girded up his loins and took off. Amen.
Amen!
That's what it is! If the Shunammite woman could have that much faith in a prophet, if Martha had that much faith in Jesus, how about today when we've got 2,000 years of miracles constantly pouring, when around the world and around the clock, 24 hours, the people are being healed and filled with the Holy Ghost the world around? Miracles of healing and raising the dead and casting out devils. Can't we be persistent to hold on to the Word of God, knowing He's no respect of person? Hold there! Persistent until He comes. Sure. Persistent. Certainly. Like the woman come down tabernacle about 3 years ago. I was in there for one night. Woman's there had a tumor weighed 50 pounds. She was out like this. Woman may be here tonight. I come in through the back door and went into the little old tabernacle there and was preaching. And so I turned around and went back. She was from California. And she couldn't walk. And she was persistent. She said, I come for Brother Branham to pray for me. And some of the elders says, he announced that he wouldn't be praying for the sick tonight. She said, which way does he go out? Not me. She had faith in God. So, two of the elders of the church, or three, got this big, heavy lady and packed her around to the little door where I got the back of the tabernacle, not knowing myself she was there to be prayed for. And I got through preaching. I started out, and she caught me by the trouser leg, and she held there. She said, Brother Branham, I won't take your time to pray for me, but just lay your hands on me. That's it. She was determined. About 6 or 8 months later, the lady standing there that night was swollen out like that. The doctors wouldn't touch her for nothing. She's been back in on my meetings down through California. We'll be there again now. She's been at the tabernacle since, just as flat as I am. They said, any of the women can come examine me. There's no mark or knife upon me. The thing left me. Wow, she was persistent.
Hallelujah.
Her faith was set. My faith is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood with righteousness. When all around my soul gives way, then he's all my hope and stay. For on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other grounds is sinking. Persistent. Their faith had a hold of his word, and it wouldn't let go, like Micah was down there before Ahab and Jehoshaphat. There was 400, I guess, fine cultured man come out, well fed, dressed, Ahab's prophets. They come out there prophesying. Jehoshaphat being a righteous man, this something didn't hit just right. See, he didn't have no faith. All them fellows standing there, the whole seminary was out. He said, look here, go up, Ahab, because they were judging. The land belongs to you, Ramoth Gilead. It's yours, so it belongs to you. Go up and take it. The Lord's with you. This guy had a great big set of horns like this. He said, by this you're going to push them all the way out of the land. Joshua looked around and see, there was no faith. No matter, he said, here's. He said, haven't you got another one? He said, another one? There's 400 of the best. They're educated. They're trained. They are men of God. But you see, there was no faith there. He said, surely you ought to have another one somewhere. He said, I got one, but I hate him. He said, he's always bawling me out. Oh, I said, let not the king say so. Go get him. Says, that's Micah, the son of Imlan. So, you know what? The deacon board went over and met him. Said, now look here, Micah, if you want to come back into the organization again, all you said against them, it'll be forgiven you. If you just say the same thing they say. You say the same thing, Micah, I like that man of God. He said, I'll say only what God puts in my mouth. So he got over before him. And he said, give me tonight. And he must have prayed all night. Long about daylight, he saw his vision. When he saw the vision, he compared it with the Word. That's the way to check where your vision's right or not.
Amen.
Not all kinds of visions is right. But if it's contrary to the Word, you leave that vision alone.
Amen.
But if it's with the Word, stay with it.
Amen.
So Micah gave his prophecy that he saw Israel scattered like sheep. Now, 400 ministers standing there, all of them well, all of them prophets, great men, ecclesiastical force. But Micah was persistent. He had checked his vision with the Word.
Hallelujah.
He knew it was right. He knew what that real prophet, Elijah, had prophesied evil against Ahab. And how could he say good when the Word said evil?
Amen.
How can you bless what God has cursed?
Amen.
Or how can you curse what God has blessed? It must be with the Word. Sometimes you have to stand alone, but stand there.
Amen.
Right. Be persistent. Stay right with it. No matter what anybody else says, stay with it.
Amen.
Micah stayed right with it.
Amen.
And of course, we find out that it proved out that he was right. Faith never denies the truth of the Word, but holds to it no matter how ridiculous it might seem. Faith holds right on to the truth of the Word. Peter, in closing, oh my, why didn't somebody pull me? I didn't know, getting that late. Excuse me, friends, I better stop right here. And I'll say just a couple more little comments here. See, then it go. Let's change it just a minute. All right. Notice. Thank you. Peter, the apostle. We'll bring it down home just for a moment. Peter, the apostle. He had a good old father. His name was Jonas. And I can just imagine Peter and Andrew and Jonas, they were fishermen. And I can see old Jonas, about 80 years old, out there with the little old feeble arms, helping him pull them nets in. He said he's losing his strength. Note it wasn't going to be very long, too, but he's going to go away. I can see him sit down on the side of the boat after a good catch that day. It prayed that morning. He said, my son's come near me. He might have said it like this. You know, we people have looked for a Messiah. And we know he's coming. I've so longed to see him. I thought surely he would come in my generation. But it seems like I'm going to go before he comes. I'm getting old. But my sons, don't be disturbed now. Just before his appearing, there's going to be all kinds of fanaticism raised up around it. Always is.
Man, hallelujah.
It's a devil trying to put a scarecrow out.
Yeah.
Scare you away. But remember, the scarecrows is always at the good tree.
Yeah.
Remember that? Not out on the old sour apples. No. It's always where good eating's at.
Amen.
So, he said, just remember. Now there'll be some raised up and saying they're this, and some are saying they're that, and some are saying they're so forth, and claiming messiahs and everything else. But don't you believe it. Now the only way to be sure is take what the Word says. Now the Word said, Moses, the prophet of God, and the Word always comes to the prophet. He said, now Moses said that the Lord your God shall raise up a prophet like unto me. Now, it's been hundreds of years since we've seen a prophet. But remember, when the Messiah cometh, he won't be saying he's that. But when he comes, he'll be a prophet. And you notice him. Now our Bible tells us if a man claims to be a prophet, and what he says comes to pass, then listen to him, because you can fear him because he's from God. But what he says doesn't come to pass, don't pay attention to it. Just go on, see, because it's not right. So now you boys remember that. And Andrew, you know, was the first one to find him. He said, hey, Simon, come on, go down to the meeting in the morning. He's going to be down here. The churches won't have him, so he's down here in another place. So you come down here. Simon said, now remember, we're Pharisees and we've got to stay. But I just want you to come. Just sit down and listen for a few moments. Watch it. So the next morning, I can see if they got through pulling the nets, why Jesus came down to the coast, and the first thing you know, Simon must have come up in the audience. And when he come walking up there, Jesus looked over right there and said, thy name is Simon, and you're the son of Jonas. Now you talk about a persistent boy, he was from then on. Nobody can make him doubt it then. He knowed it because why? He had saw that sign of a Messiah.
Amen.
He saw the Word. He knew that the man didn't know him, didn't know his name, didn't know nothing about him. And here he told him not only him, but who his father was and what his name was. The very one that told him to look for this sign.
Yeah.
He was persistent. Little old Philip, when he heard this story, he didn't have to see it. He believed it. Of course, he was looking for a Messiah. He was so persistent until he went around the hillside about 15 miles and he found a guy named Nathaniel. He didn't have to go back and say, now wait, let's sit down and calculate this. He said, come see who we have found. The one that Moses spoke of. Hey man, I can hear him tell the story about Simon. Oh, Philip Meyer, Nathaniel might have said, now wait a minute, Philip, you're going off on the deep end, just come see. See if I'm on the deep end. So when he walked up in the prayer line or in the audience, wherever it was, I can see Nathaniel begin to look around and say, I have a good feeling here tonight, somehow. Looks pretty good. And Jesus caught his eye and he said, Behold, there is an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. That tucked him off the rocker. He said, Rabbi, when did you know me? He said, before Philip called you, when you were under the tree, I saw you. And he looked around, he saw all of his pastors and the deacons and the presbyters and the bishops and all of them standing around. But brother, he got very persistent right then. He said, Rabbi, you are the Son of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There you are. He was persistent. Why? He saw something, he heard something, he realized that it was scriptural, so he could stand persistently, regardless of what the rest of them thought.
Amen.
He seen something. He had a hold to something. He held on to it. The little woman at the well, ill-famed. She'd seen so much bogus amongst the people, professing. One day she, about, must have been about 11 o'clock, they went into Sychar to get some food. The disciples and Jesus left alone. The Father sent him up there because he had need to go by. He was going to Jericho, but he went up around the mountain because he had need. One soul and her prostitute. Oh, amazing grace. One soul out of the whole thing and her an ill fame. Called him off of his regular journey from up here. She might have been about 11 o'clock. She came out to get some water. She might have started to let the bucket down. Her curls dropped down over her face. And she started to let the bucket down. She heard somebody say, bring me a drink. She looked over quickly. There sat a Jew. She said, it's not customary for such a thing. Jude asked Samaritan, and he said, but if you knew who you were talking to, you'd ask me for a drink. What was he doing? Contacting her spirit. Father sent him up there. Now the subject is there. Hallelujah. I saw something in him. Oh, God. Father sent him up there. And now here's the subject before him. He don't know what to say. But he carries a conversation. He said, talked about worship at Jerusalem and the Jews and so forth and the well they talked about. After a while, he found where her trouble was. He said, go get your husband to come here. She said, I have no husband. He said, that's right, you've had five and the one you got now is not your husband. She said, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. We know that the Messiah is called the Christ. He's coming, the anointed one. And when he comes, he'll be a prophet. He'll tell us those things. He said, I'm he that speaks to you. Talk about persistence. You know, it wasn't actually, if you know the Oriental custom, a woman of that type should not never approach a man in a marketplace. That's right. Not till this day in India and different places. No, sir. The man wouldn't even hear her. Look at her. She's marked. A prostitute that turned her back. No matter what she said. But what? They couldn't ignore her. They couldn't ignore the woman. Why? She had a hold of faith. She had a message. They couldn't stop her. She said, come see a man who's told me the things that I've done. Isn't this the very Messiah? Isn't this he? And the Bible said the whole city believed because of the woman's testimony. The little woman with the blood issue. She's persistent. I imagine she's seen all the denomination standing there, and she pressed right on by him. Mom said, wait a minute, where are you going? Aren't you John Doe's wife up there on the hill that he just swapped that team of horses the other day to pay the doctor? Yeah, but he couldn't do me no good. Well, you're too frail. You'll get tramped on down there in that bunch of people. Listen at them. They're nothing but a bunch of fanatics. It's Galilean backwash. They don't even belong to an organization. All he does is tear up our churches. Go on back up there. I'll call your pastor. She just ignored it. She just persisted. Well, you're too weak to go to the meeting. That didn't stop her a bit. She's going anyhow. Little pale cheeks. She's going anyhow. Going anyhow. Maybe her husband said, get back up down the hill where you belong. See? You are my husband and I love you, but I must touch you. Walk right on past it. You're still there. Say, Brother Dave, she passed another line of people. They said, the day's a miracle. And the bishop come around like this and said, hey, we heard you done miracles. Now let's see you do another one. The other one stepped in this way, that way. Finally, she thought, how am I going to do it? But you know, faith always finds a way to do it. Like the Serapis open woman. Faith finds a way to touch him. If you don't believe it, you get to praying right now and see if your faith don't find a way to touch him. Faith finds the way. And after a while, reminds me of Abraham Lincoln. They shut him out. Great man. He said, how are you going to get in? He said, I'm going to trust God. He said, they're going to close the doors in your faith. He said, I'll still trust God. So when all the senators answered, they're going to throw him out on this measure that they're trying to vote against. And so they know Abraham Lincoln was for it. He had such a pressure and such a status before the people that he could put his point over. And they wouldn't let him in the door. And when they got up and began to call the names, they called different ones and different ones. And there was Lincoln's seat empty. Said, Abraham Lincoln? Brrr, down to the chimney. Said, present? Faith finds a way. It might be down the chimney. But it'll get there. What difference does it make? So it arrives. Faith finds a way. It may be crawling, maybe singing, maybe shouting. Whatever it is, it finds its way. Moves right on. She'd try to touch and blocked off and blocked off. Finally, she just stooped down and reached over and touched his garment. Jesus turned and said, who touched me? Why? She had perseverance. She touched him. I must close. I just feel so good. I hate to do it. But we got a big prayer line coming up. Listen, I was in Mexico about 4 years ago, and they told us we could have the bull ring. General Valdinia brought me down, first American non-Catholic had ever been brought down. When the bishop of the Catholic Church went up before the president, and said, your honor, sir, this man is coming in here non-Catholic and said he gets government support from General Valdinia, military support. Said our nation doesn't stand for that. And so the president said back, he said, the man's a reputable man. Said, he's just a renegade. Said, I don't think tens of thousands of people go out here a renegade. And he said, but you see, sir, the bishop said to the president, you see, sir, only the poor and illiterate is the only thing that goes to hear him. He said, you've had them for 500 years. Why are they poor and illiterate? That was a good question. They wouldn't let us have the bull ring. So we got a great big place out there. And those poor Mexicans, thinking we sitting here listening for an hour and a half and get tired many times. Those people come there at 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. No seats. They stood up. Leaning against one another. All day I wouldn't be in the pulpit till about 8 or 9 o'clock at night, but stood there so we'd get a place to stand. About 30,000. And there they were, all leaning against each other. I was just to be there 3 nights. And I remember one night there, second night, coming across the platform was I seen standing on the platform that Billy had led him up, an old Mexican man. His feet was calloused all over. His pants all ragged, no shirt on, just a coat wrapped around it, ragged, an old hat tied up with strings. He's blind. He kept saying something when he got close to me, took out a little beads and went to saying a Hail Mary. I had him put it up. So I put my arm around him. I looked out of me with a good pair of shoes on, a suit of clothes. Got just as much right to have a pair of shoes and a suit as I have. Yes, sir. So I thought, I'll give it to the old man, see? His feet was much bigger than mine. His shoulders were out like that. I looked at his gray hair, blind. I thought my daddy would live. He'd been about that age. It may be somebody's daddy. I put my arms around and started praying. And when I opened my eyes like this, they don't interpret the prayer. I seen the old man going around looking as well as he, you know, as can see and everything in the vision. I just held real still. Rick, I heard him. I heard, glory a Dios. Means glory to God. He could see as good as I could. Oh, down through there he went, lippity-clippity as hard as he could. The amazing grace. The next night, there was a rick much longer than this platform, piled out high of old shawls and coats, laying up there to be prayed over. And when I got on the platform that night, it had been raining since about 10 o'clock in the morning. Those people stood right through the rain, them Mexican women with their hair all down in their face and just soaking wet. And I had to get on a ladder and come down a wall. They picked me up in the car, let me down on these ropes on a ladder to get on the platform right beside the wall where I'd come around the wall in a car. And I was speaking, and Billy come over to me and said, Daddy, a Mexican man, I don't know what his name was, I call him Mañana, which means tomorrow. He was so slow. And so he's always, he'd come get me, and it's about, they brought him because he couldn't talk to me. Nobody talks to me when we're coming to the meeting. And he couldn't talk English, so I just called him Mañana. And so he would blabber off something. I didn't pay attention because I didn't know what he was saying. So he got me on the platform that night, and I was speaking, and Billy come running up. He said, Daddy, Mañana, give out all them prayer cards. And said, there's a little woman down there. She's got a dead baby. And said, I've got over 150, 200, I forget what it was, ushers. And they can't stop that woman. Said she's got that dead baby on her hip, and she'll run between their legs and run over their shoulders and everything else for that dead baby. And said she ain't getting no prayer card. And said, we done give them all out. And if I put her in line ahead of them people that come and got a prayer card, there'll be a riot as sure as the world. And now, Brother Jack Moore. Anybody ever know Brother Jack Moore? Many of you. He was with me. So I said, Brother Jack, she don't know me from you. I said, go on over there and pray for the baby, and it'll be all right. And these ushers were taking hold of that. And she'd stand there. As soon as they turned her head, she'd run out between her feet like that, as hard as she could. And she'd upset four or five of them. They'd shove her back again. They couldn't keep her off the platform. All persistent, my. And so our Brother Jack started over to pray for the little baby. Billy was taking him over. And I said, as I was saying, then Brother Espinosa, a Pentecostal brother from California, was giving an interpretation. I said, now faith is a substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. And when Brother Espinosa started to say that, I looked right out here about 2 or 3 feet from here, and there was a little Mexican baby in the vision. Little old, no teeth, just gums, just laughing at me. And I rubbed my eyes. I looked again, there it was, little bitty fella. He's just laughing, them little black eyes just staring. I thought, wonder if that's that baby. I said, hold it just a minute, Brother Espinosa. Brother Jack was going off the platform. I said, tell the ushers, Brother Espinosa, make a way and let the lady come up. She's standing about the distance of this building out there, still pressing her way with this dead baby in a blanket. It died that morning about 9 o'clock. The doctor pronounced it dead. Died with pneumonia. So she, they made a way, and here she come up the platform. She fell down and began to holler, Padre, means father. I tried to get her to stand up. When she stood up, Brother Espinosa said, has she got a prayer card? I said, no. But Brother Espinosa, don't say this. I don't know. I seen a little Mexican baby in a vision right out before me here. And I said, it may be her baby. I'll just pray and let it go on like that. He said, all right. I said, don't interpret the prayer. And I told her to stand up, and Espinosa told her in Spanish to stand up. She stood up. I said, when's your baby die? 9 this morning. It was about 10:30 then, that night. And I said, you believe? With all her heart. Wasn't a doubt in the little thing. My pretty little woman looked to be about in her early 20s, 22 or 23. Typical little Mexican señorita. So she had this little baby in a little blanket over it. There it was laying there just soaking wet. That blanket, she'd been standing out there since that morning. She'd seen a piece of paper about that old man getting his sight, so she was ready to bring that baby. And I asked her if she believed. She said, yes. So I laid my hands over on the little baby. I said, Heavenly Father, now I don't know. I just saw the vision. And upon the basis of that vision, it may be the baby. That's all you said to me. I'm just going to put my hands on it, commit it to you. And the little baby went, whack! And began to kick his little feet like that. And I looked around, she jerked the blanket off of it, and people began screaming, and I said, now don't you say nothing about this, Brother Espinosa. Get a runner, get somebody on that case, and go and get a signed statement from the doctor before you say anything, because if you're going to say anything about it, it's got to be authentic. So she, and he got a runner, and the next day he himself, they went to the doctor, he signed a statement that the baby died that morning at 9 o'clock, and that was that night at 10 o'clock. And the baby, as far as I know, is living in Mexico tonight, happy. Wow!
Because a woman like this little Syrophoenician woman, she was persistent. She knew she had a hold of God, Catholic or no Catholic, priest or no priest, church or no church, excommunicate or no excommunicate, laugh at or no laugh at. What was she? She was persevering. She knew that there was a God. Listen, Bible promise signs proves he keeps his word. Bible promise signs. We can read them and be persistent and know that he keeps his word. Let us pray. Before we pray, is there something here tonight that would like to be remembered in this prayer? Whatever you have need of, would just raise your hand and say, God, make me persistent, Lord, till I can get the desire of my heart. It's for your glory. Lord, stay right with me. Let me stay with you. Give me a hold on you tonight. I'm going to watch. I'm going to listen. I'm going to believe. When others are being prayed for, I'm going to believe tonight. I'm going to be persistent. That I'll never leave this building until I've got an anchor in my faith. My faith is anchored in me, rather, that I am going to be very perseverant. Because I believe I want to get a hold of your word right now for my case. Our Heavenly Father, you see the hands. The story of this little Gentile woman. How that she was persistent. She was very perseverant because faith had come by hearing and hearing of God's word. And with all of her hindrances, and here we sit tonight, well, not one third the hindrances she had. Her daughter was an epileptic, and she was a Gentile, which God had not promised to visit. She was turned down by her friends. She was turned down probably by all that we spoke of tonight. But we know that even Jesus tested her faith, told her that he wasn't sent to her, and said that she and her race was dogs. And the truth was, Lord, when faith gets a hold of the word, it admits the truth. Said, but the dogs get the scraps. And that touched the heart of our Master. He said, O woman, great is your faith. Be it unto you as thou hast believed. And when she got home, the fit was off of her daughter, and she was lying across the bed. The devil had left her. Heavenly Father, give us that faith tonight. May we come and after tonight be perseverant in our faith. Because we can have faith if we know you've promised it in your word. Anything that you promised and our faith takes a hold of, it belongs to us. You told Joshua, everywhere the soles of your feet sets, that I've given you. And we realize that footsteps meant possession. Father, if some of them tonight has never walked high enough up into the kingdom of God to receive the Holy Ghost, may they receive it tonight. May they make footsteps tonight, footprints. And then them who have never been able to reach up high enough and walk up there and possess the blessing of divine healing, may they walk up tonight. Be persistent. May faith catch a hold of them right now by these remarks from these others. Those who've never accepted you as Savior, may they reach up tonight and get a hold of you and accept you. The Bible said, as many as believe was baptized. Grant it, Father, and may they be baptized also in water and also in the Holy Spirit. Grant these blessings and help your poor, humble servant as I minister now in the name of thy Son, Jesus. Amen. Now, I believe that Billy Paul, if he's in the building, said that he gave out prayer cards. And I think he said 50. Is that right? 50 prayer cards. And we want them to stand up. Now don't race at it. Just come one by one. Who has prayer card number one? Someone? What's that? A1. All right, A1. Is it the gentleman? A2. Would you raise your hand? Right? A2. Did I see the hand of that person? A2. All right, sister. A3. 3, all right, 4, 5, raise your hand, I didn't see 4 even. 4, all right, next in line. 5, raise your hand. Prayer card 5. Now Billy comes down to the audience, gets up here, shuffles the cards up together, gives the people a card. Anybody wants them, anybody have to be here to get them, of course. And I think if they come early and got a prayer card, they ought to have right to be first up here, don't you think so?
Amen.
Right. And now, but Billy don't know who's going to be first on the line because the prayer cards are shuffled up. That makes it to him. Then sometimes I start vice versa, backwards, upside. You've seen it done also.
Yeah.
That's right. Last night we didn't even have any prayer cards at all. See, that isn't the idea. All right, 5, 6, raise your hand. 7, all right, as I call it a number, you stand up. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, just make your way over here and get in the line right on here. 12, now if you can't raise up, some of the brethren will come get you and pack it. You're going to get up here, yes sir.
Amen.
All right, 12, did I see 12? Prayer card 12, all right, 13, 14, 15. Be watching your card now. 15, 15, 15, 16, 17, 17, 18, 18. Back 19. Thank you, Brother Vail. 19, 20, 21, 21. I didn't get it. 21, 22, 22. Prayer card 22. Well, thank you. Let me know, you know, because it might be somebody deaf in the midst of your place, you see, or somebody can't get up. Somebody watch the other's prayer card and then be looking at your prayer card. What was that, 22? 23? 23? 20, prayer card 23? 24? 25? 26? Good. 27? 28? 29? 29? 29, 30, thank you. 31, 32, 33, I didn't see it. 34, 34, 35, 36, 37, I didn't get it. 37, look around your neighbor, he might have a prayer card. 37, he might be deaf, might be able, can't get up, he's paralyzed and can't move. 37, somebody must have got it and went out. If they come in, put them in a line, position in their place now. The ushers will be there to help. 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 47, that's good, 48, 49, 50, 50, the man back there. Now, is all the people that has prayer cards up? Has anybody else got a prayer card? All prayer cards standing in the row. I want to be sure of this now. We call one 37. I've seen a couple of brethren come in since then. I just wonder, I've called prayer card 37 and it didn't answer. That's the only one that I've seen myself that didn't answer. Was prayer card number 5. Did it answer? Brother Vail said he didn't notice prayer card number 5. Number 5, is it there? And 37. Now, if you just give us a moment or two, friends, now we'll do someone coming in again with the baby. Maybe it might be some of the women and brothers has to step out with their little ones. And if they're out now and that number comes in, put them right in line, right in their place. Put them where 37 and 5 belongs. And that makes everything just right then. 37 and 5. Everybody now, be alert, be ready, be willing. Now, thank you.
That's way, that's better. Thank you, sir. Hear that better now? The reason they're doing this is because under the anointing, I don't talk very loud. Now, while they're getting them together, I might say this. I want it from your heart. If you don't believe it, don't raise your hand. But if you do believe it, I want you to raise your hand. Now, we know that Christianity has been growing in the grace of God through the years. Martin Luther was the first reformer from the Dark Age, and he preached justification by faith. How many knows that? Then the church was like in the, like a pyramid. It was down here. Great, anybody even professed to be a Christian, it was dangerous to be killed. Then along come Wesley with the message of sanctification. Then it become more in the minority. Then after Wesley come the Pentecostal group. Then it become up, and anyone knows, not teaching pyramid doctrines now or anything, I'm just giving an example. But the headstone was never put on the pyramid. Why? It was rejected. So if the headstone would come to the pyramid, if anybody's ever been in Egypt, those stones are so closely fit together till you can't place a razor blade between them. That's where the mystery, how to get them up there. They fit perfect. Now the headstone, it'll have to be the stones that's made up here at the top, ready for the headstone. It'll have to be honed so perfectly until when the headstone comes, it'll have to fit just exactly with it to make the building complete. Is that right? So the church, now if the headstone come in Luther's time, look what an out-of-way place it would have been. Look if it come in Wesley's time. It'll come in its own predestinated time.
Amen.
But the church will be honed in such a condition until the church's ministry will be so close and be just exactly the same kind of ministry that Jesus had to make it all fit together for the rapture. Like the head knows more than the feet. See? The eyes are more used than the feet. The eyes is the prophet of the church. It foresees. See? And all these things come in the head. The head part. Now, I want to ask you a question. Excuse me, brother. This may be off the beaten path. But if I'm wrong, you forgive me. You brothers out there. I believe that the church will have to come to that spot.
Amen.
For the rapture.
Amen.
To be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. I believe that we're living in that day.
Amen.
That when the church will certainly be in a minority.
Amen.
It'll be a small group. You know, when Jesus preached, it was 1% of the 1 millionth of the people on earth ever heard him. Look what heard John to make preparations. See, it's the elected that hears it.
Hallelujah.
That's all.
Hallelujah.
Right. No man can come to me except my Father draws him first. And all the Father has given me will come. Right. Now, I believe that there's a church coming into that perfection. That ministry of perfection, where the offices were apostles, prophets, teachers, pastors, evangelists, for the perfecting of the church, then pastors and teachers and so forth will be so with the Word until the whole thing will work right up to the coming of the Lord. I believe that, and I believe we're nearing that time now. I believe it so. Now we know that Jesus said, has taught us all through the scriptures that the works that he did would be done also. Now, my brethren, I hope if they do disagree with me, if it'll be on a friendly basis. Did you know the Bible speaks of the appearing of the Lord and also the coming of the Lord in his two different words?
Yes. Amen.
Search it and find out if that's right. The appearing and the coming is two different things.
Yes.
The appearing of the Lord is now. He's appearing amongst his people.
Yes.
We see him in his same works, the appearing, his Holy Spirit. But his coming will be in a physical being.
Yeah.
If he catch the church up. But see, we've been down through the Word. Justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost. And now the church is getting in such a condition, ready, waiting. The offices and the offices of the church is coming into its place. The teachers are placing the places. The gifts are manifesting themselves. Oh, there's a lot of impersonations. That's right. We expect that, but there's real too. Before there can be a bogus dollar, there has to be a real one for it to be made off of. That's right. We have all those carnal comparisons, but that don't take away from the real. It only makes the real shine out. So the Lord is now appearing among his people. Great signs and wonders, raising the dead, healing the sick, and doing the very same things that he did that hasn't been done for 2,000 years. See, the church is honed up through that, brought up, so it's right at the time. The headstone is coming to meet the church, and it'll be all go together and be raptured. The ones fell asleep in the first watch, second watch, third watch, on the seventh watch. The appearing of the Lord. Last night I touched it, how he had come. Now remember, not the man, that's the office in the church. Not the marvelous teacher man, it's the marvelous Holy Ghost teaching in the man. Not the marvelous man with the gift of discernment, the marvelous Holy Ghost in there using the man. See? Always said, like Peter referred to it one time, the Mount Transfiguration, the holy mountain. It isn't the holy mountain, it's the holy God on the holy mountain. It's not the holy church, it's the holy God. Not the holy people, but the Holy Ghost. See? It's the Holy Spirit. These last days. Now, when that angel of the Lord came to Abraham, there in the time before the destruction, now that was God appearing in human flesh, and Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the coming of the Son of Man. And as it was in the days of Lot, he gave the morals of what they were doing in the days of Noah. In the days of Lot, what's that messenger to Abraham? What's the messengers to Lot in the nominal church? Is come out, come out. Abraham pleading for them. Notice the angel, God, Elohim, appearing in a form of human flesh, shows that Elohim in the last days will appear, not the coming of Christ, but the appearing of Christ in human flesh in his church. Making the same signs and things that he did and hasn't done it in the church for 2,000 years.
Amen.
See? The appearing of the Lord. Now, is all the prayer cards in the line? How many sick out there and hasn't got a prayer card? Raise up your hand. Do that again. Raise up your hands, all is sick. All is praying. Believe me. All right? The woman that touched the border of his garment, she didn't have a prayer card either, but she touched his garment. And the Bible said that he right now is a high priest. Is that right? Ever living to make intercession. A high priest that can be touched by the feeling of our infirmity. Is that right? And the Bible said in Hebrews 13:18, it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Is that true?
Amen.
Well then, if he's the same high priest, if you touched him like that woman did, not physically, her faith touched him, because he said virtue when everybody was touched him physically, but her faith touched him. And he turned around and noted her blood issue and said her faith had saved her. Don't you believe he's the same high priest tonight?
Amen.
And if these words are true, he's appearing in human flesh, then you let him appear in your flesh, giving you faith in his promised word. St. John 14:12, the works that I do shall you also. Then I'll, if these offices in the church, then let me relax myself before you and William Branham Park go away and let the Lord Jesus speak through me. Appear in human flesh, like he appears in yours. So there will be a witness of two, and two is a confirmation in God's Word. Two is a witness. Then you have faith to touch him, and I have faith, and through both of us confirms his Word that is the truth. Now you sick people again, out there.
Now, I can't go down through that discernment to that line. You know, it would take me right off the platform.
One little woman caused the Son of God to say he got weak.
In him, the Son of God.
What do you think I would be? A sinner saved by his grace. I couldn't even stand one of them if he didn't say, the works that I do shall you also, and more than this shall you do. I know the King James says greater, but it's actually more. Say greater, he couldn't do no greater. He raised the dead, stopped nature, done everything, see? So just more of it, because there'd be more people. The Spirit was just one man there. Now it's universal around the world and all these people. Believe. Let's just take for a start. These crowd in this way. How many there that doesn't know me, and I don't know you, and you're sick, and you believe that God can reveal to you your trouble, raise up your hands. All of you there that has got prayer cards, and you want something from God, raise up your hand. In here? Over here? You pray. Let me turn my back. You pray. The angel that appeared in human flesh had his back turned to the tent where Sarah was. And he told Sarah what she did. Is that right? That same angel was God. And the same God that was there was promised by Jesus, who was God, to appear in his last days before the burning of the earth, just like he did in the days of Sodom. You believe.
Amen.
Of course it's a vision. There's people standing there, I don't know. It'd be up to him. Here he is. If I can find where it was. Yep. The lady sitting right here. Heavy set. Did you raise your hand a few minutes ago? You believe God will heal that rheumatism for you and make you well? Can you raise up your hand? Right? You can have. What did she touch? The man sitting next to her, what do you think, brother? You believe that comes from God?
Yes, sir.
You do?
Yes.
You believe God can tell me what's your trouble? Would you believe it?
Yes.
Would you accept it if I could tell you through God's Spirit? I'm talking to you, you're sitting close to me. You believe it? Will you believe it? All right, then your high blood pressure will leave you. That man sitting next to you had the same thing, a little thin man there. He had high blood pressure too. If that's true, raise up your hands, both of you. Go believe him. Don't doubt. What did they touch? They never touched me. I don't know the people. I've never seen them in my life. Y'all strangers to me. If you just believe, that's all you have to do.
Amen.
There's a little lady standing there right back there, looking right at you. She's just tearing into the kingdom of God. She's praying for her unsaved sons. If you'll believe with all your heart, they'll be saved. Will you believe it? You can have it. You believe? All of it? You believe God will heal that nervousness for you, sir, sitting there? He's asking to do it by then.
Yes, sir.
Oh man, it's all over. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
The little lady sitting back there praying for that grandchild. You believe that God will make it well? Retarded, but you believe that God will make it well? You believe with all your heart? Plan on bringing to church tomorrow night. You won't have to. God will make it well and you bring it. How about it, lady? You believe it? Right, I'm a total stranger to woman. I don't know her at all. I've never seen her in my life. Are we strangers to one another, lady? If it is, raise up your hand. What's that much as praying for them waving your hand like that? Don't you see? Elohim! God! How can you doubt? Can't you be persistent? Just to start it, you're in the line. Now you had a prayer card. They didn't. You believe me to be his servant. You believe I've told you the truth tonight on God's word. I don't know you. Never seen him alive. We're strangers as far as I know. But do you believe if God can tell me what's wrong with you or something, you know where it's the truth or not. You know what I might tell you what has been, then tell you what will be. Well, you know that will be right. You're not here for yourself. You're standing for somebody else. That person's not here. That's your wife. She's in another state. She's in Georgia. She's got kidney trouble. She's very sick. Got complications. That is right, isn't it? Do you believe with all your heart now? Go home and find her the way you believe it. That's what you don't doubt. If thou didst believe, all things are possible for thee. Amen. That was a man. Here's a woman. Let's have this one more. And then we'll start just praying for the sick. See if we can get down that line. Come near me, sister. I believe we're strangers one to another. We're just two people met here. Very same way in a panoramic like this at Sychar there where Jesus met the woman at the well. Here we are, man and woman met first time in life. Oh, I wish that I could see the power Satan moved away. How can we stand and see this and then not believe? Here's a man and woman. We've never seen one another. She's just a woman standing here. I don't know one thing. I've never seen her in my life. Now, what about it? I don't know one thing. What is it? God promised it. God's word says so. He promised me that one night up there many years ago. Said I was born for this. I believe it. Tens of thousands of times around the world and not one time it's ever failed. What is it? It's showing you that the time is at hand. It isn't me, it's him. How do I know this woman? The old brother that had his son healed, he said, I know it has to be God. Brother Brandon, people in my neighborhood, I know. They said, I know it's a promise for the last day and it's here. The Bible in Malachi 4 promised it.
Amen. Amen.
He said it must come to pass. Before the great and terrible day of the Lord shall come that shall burn the earth. And we know we're living in that day. Here's two people standing here. I don't know the woman. 4, 5, 6, 7 or whatever what it was out there. And there's a whole line. If I could only stand here long enough. That's what I'm trying to do now. Get myself shuffled away enough that I go on with the prayer line. Does something to you. It's a constant like a throb out there in that audience. It's faith. Oh, if you can just ever break through that little barrier there. Get free. Like a bird getting out of a cage. He's got the wings. Just get out the door. Lady, just to talk to you a minute now. I don't know you, but God does know you. Then, if something you'll have to say that if he will tell me something about you, what you're here for, like the woman touched his garment or something on that, or some Bible sign to show that it, you know it has to be something because I don't know you. Then if it would, you know where it'd be the truth or not, because you know about it. And then if it is the truth, my, wouldn't that be wonderful? My, certainly would. Now, the lady's very sick. I see it now. See her at the doctor's. Been turned down by the doctor. She's suffering with all kinds of complications. One thing, you've got a hernia. And you're supposed to have an operation. And you've got such a bad heart, till there's no doctor will take the case. That's thus saith the Lord. But there is one here. If I pray for you, you know there's some kind of anointing here, is that right? Do you believe it? Our Heavenly Father, heal my sister tonight and make this disease for me in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Prayer of patience, God shall bring
you. You're conscious that I know what's wrong with you. Would it help if I told you? Or would you just, if I pray for you, you know there's some kind of anointing here that knows you've got heart. Go ahead. Now, when you were sitting right out there a few moments ago, and I asked anybody that had a need, raise up their hand. You raise up your hand, and when you raise up your hand, a real strange feeling hits you up. Because that's when your nervousness left you. You're on your own. If I pray for you, you get it. Well, anyhow, wouldn't you?
But would it help me if I told you that you were here, Lord? It was female trouble, ladies' trouble. You believe now? Going to be well.
You just believe with all your heart.
Now, what if I just put my hands on you and just pray for you? You believe me? Heavenly Father, grant you this mission. Jesus, you said how much greater is their faith, their reward you have never seen yet. I pray that you be, Father. You're conscious that I know what's wrong. Don't do any good, all to tell you. You believe I just pray for it. Heavenly Father, may it call you more. May it go. May it be in Jesus' name. You believe it?
Amen.
I can heal you, I would do it. I can't heal you. I can pray for you. Will you be able to hear me? Our Heavenly Father, I bless my brother in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Grant his healing. Believe it? Come, sir. You believe you'll hear our prayer? I can heal you, I do it. I can't. I can only pray. You believe it? Heavenly Father, as the serving old woman may, it is desired tonight for a woman to be well in Jesus' name. Amen. You believe? I pray for you. You get over it. It'd be a great relief, wouldn't it? They've tried everything. You won't ask the door and everything else, but it just don't do no good. But God is the healer. You mean this one? Our Heavenly Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll heal this woman and make her well. I lay my hands upon it. Well, Lord, I believe that your spirit is here. You just got us anointed. I pray that you'll heal her. Prayer, thank you. God shall raise him up. Yeah, I'll be real reverent, sit still. Now, see, he might call something out there. If you're moving around, I can't catch it, you see, because each one of you is a spirit, and if you're in contact, you see, when you do, when you move, it upsets me, you see. You understand? See? Jesus took a man and led him from out of the city, away from all the unbelief. See? He sat real still and in prayer. Here's a lady. You believe God can tell me what your trouble is? Would you accept it? Look at me. You got a girl. You believe God can tell me where the girl is? It's in the New Testament. That's right. You believe that God will heal it? You go what you have to need, so what does he do? All right? God will respect the person. If he heal that lady going down there, that's a female trouble. He'll heal you too. How do you do, sister? You believe if I ask him, he'll make you well. I can't heal you, but I can ask him. You believe you're good? I believe you're already healed. Don't you believe so? Right? That's the way. You believe if we'll ask God? Jesus said this, these signs shall follow them that believe. If they lay their hands on the sick, they shall recover. You believe it, I believe you. Then in the name of Jesus Christ, I obey his commandments for you. Amen. You also believe it, sister? You believe passing through here? You're not coming just come by Brother Branham because it wouldn't be no good. But you're coming believing it. Christ is standing here somewhere that we don't see. Is that right? Come. Heavenly Father, I bless this woman in the name of Jesus Christ. May she be healed. You believe, sister? Our Heavenly Father, I pray that in Jesus' name that you'll heal this sister and make her well. God bless you, my brother. Vine and line, all that's known. You believe that God will make you well?
Yes.
Our Heavenly Father, only you can heal this man. I pray for him. Put my hands upon him and asking if he will be made every with you. Granted in Jesus' name, I pray. God bless you, my brother. Don't believe me. You believe Jesus. Heavenly Father, I ask for her healing in the name of Jesus Christ. God bless you. Come around on both of you.
Yes.
Bless your heart. My, this is sweet. I hope someday to see my papa and mama come down through the kingdom of God. If I pray for you, you believe it, you'll make you well.
Yes.
Our Heavenly Father, this little couple, I lay my hands upon them with all the reverence and respects that I know how. And if it lay within my power, I would make them whole. I cannot do it, Lord, but I believe in you who will. I ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Lord, and I'm hoping that you be well and live a good, happy, long life. Very kind of my God. That's the most horrible thing. No one knows about it. Everybody tells you, get next to yourself, and how can you? Nervous. Oh my, that old dark shadow following you all the time. Nothing you can do, everything's gone wrong, and that's it. You believe you'll let me cast it away from you. Satan, come out of her. In the name of Jesus Christ, leave this poor little woman. Shame on you. I adjure thee by the living God, whose presence is here now, whose servant I am. Let it be from this night on. Thank you. God bless you, lady. With all my faith and hope, you're free. Go on your road and join me. You believe, my brother? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, let the power that raised Jesus from the grave quicken his body and make him well. Amen. Lord, bless you, my brothers. You believe, sister? Our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, your Son, I lay my hands on this woman while we're in the presence of this shrouded presence of Jesus Christ. May she be healed. Amen. Bless you, sister. Oh, just rejoice and happy believing. Come, sister, you and brother. Let's have your hand. Heavenly Father, I bless them. In the name of Jesus Christ, may they get their desires tonight, be made perfectly whole, and live for the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Don't believe in God. Don't doubt. Just believe. Can you believe? Does everybody believe? Many times people think everybody has to be told. You don't have to be told. I know it. And if we go to talking about it, it just keeps getting more and more and more. And see, they get weaker, 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 and that line is still long. But God knows everything. Don't you believe that? Surely He does. How many believes where you say anything or not? Just believe. He didn't believe me when I just started that. He's still here. He's here. You believe it? What about you? You believe it? I don't know you. God knows you. Do you believe He can tell what's wrong with you? If I tell you, you'd be surprised. You just get real weak. Got weak spells. That's right. You believe that He can make you well from that? A preacher wants to preach the gospel? You are a minister. You just get so weak you can't preach. Isn't that right? But you can be strong from now on. You believe you are? Then go on your road and say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, America, America. How oh, God would have heard you.
Something strange about you. Oh, I know now. Here it is. You're the lady that I met in the restroom. It's over. In the name of Jesus Christ, let this woman go home now, being well. Lord, let her recover from this. I believe you will, because today that great mysterious leading into that restroom, knowing what's caused this, the poor woman's tried to shake free a long time, but now she's coming free. Go in Jesus' name and be well. Thank you. Please. All right, sir. You believe by asking, you'll be made well? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, grant the healing of my brother, and I lay hands on him for the glory of God. Amen. God bless you, my brother. Go. God bless you, my brother. Many days have been along here. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, oh, if I could only hold my daddy tonight like this. But it's her helping God. Bless her too, Father. May they have the healing. Live a long life and someday in glory when they were all turned back to the young people again. May I meet them again. The testimony of Jesus Christ, I ask this blessing.
Amen.
God bless you. Go believing, be all right. Just have faith in God. God bless you. Isn't that sweet? You believe, young man? In the name of Jesus Christ, I obey His commandments. I lay my hand upon yours and ask Him that the devil depart.
Amen.
Do you believe, sister? Then in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you said these signs shall follow believers. Let her be well. Amen. Don't doubt. Just go now. Be perseverant. Believe it. How do you do, sister? This is the hour of deliverance for you. You believe it? In the name of Jesus Christ, may she be set free right now. God bless you. Brother, I know what an old stick means to be hobbling around with. This will be the hour of deliverance. Are you going to be persevering in the presence of God now? Not in our presence, but His presence. That I'll pray for you, and you're going to get well. Do you believe it? Our Heavenly Father, I bless our brother in the name of Jesus Christ, and may the power of God make him well. Leave it now. On your may the little fellow be set free in the name of Jesus Christ. May it be from denial. Watch what happens.
Hallelujah. Bless my sister, Lord.
My crippled out arm. I wish you could stretch it out to the Lord Jesus tonight and say, bless you and make you well. Heavenly Father, I pray for this boy. I pray that the power that can make him well, Jesus Christ, will heal him. May he return and show you the blessings of God is come upon you. In Jesus Christ's name. God bless you. Lord. We'll believe you. How do you do, little devil? I think he will, won't you? The little boy can talk. So just believe. Now we're going to pray and ask God. I believe that little boy will come back.
Amen. Amen.
Not a bad opportunity? No, no. Our Heavenly Father, may the dumb spirit upon this child depart. And may the child talk in the name of Jesus Christ. Gracious God, who brought back Jesus from the dead, heal this sister and make her well as I lay my unworthy hands upon her, but believing in Christ, the worthy one. I ask for her healing. Amen.
Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, as this woman crosses the platform, humbly, reverently, knowing that healing is something that's already been done, the people believe it. And as I said tonight, be like that woman of long ago, persistent, persevering. They believe it. God shows them His sign. They accept it. They believe it. May she be healed in Jesus' name. Amen. You believe, sister. Our Heavenly Father, the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and God shall raise them up. I pray that you'll grant this blessing to our sister, that what she asks for, in the name of Jesus Christ, I lay my prayer with hers, my faith with hers, and may it be granted. Amen. God bless you, sister. How do you do, sister? You believe it, you'll make him well. I'll put my faith with yours, and we'll lay our prayer on his altar, and believe it in his presence. Our Heavenly Father, I pray for this dear woman, as she stands here tonight, crippled. All these things, Father, I pray that you'll grant her recovery, God. I'm laying my prayer upon the altar with her, placing my faith upon the sacrifice, Christ Jesus, and asking that she will be made well. Amen. Believe me, with all your heart. How do you do, brother? Do you believe that God will make you well? Our Heavenly Father, is this young, gallant-looking man stands here before me? We're standing in your presence as a brethren. I ask you, Lord, as I lay my prayer with his, grant it, Lord, that he will be given his request in Jesus' name. Amen. Believe it. Be persistent. Hold on to it. It's been asked. So let it be done. You believe with me now. You can go back down south well. Our Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll grant his request. I lay my prayer with his prayer, my faith with his faith, all in your Bible and in the blood of Jesus Christ. We ask it in his name. Amen. The prayer of faith shall save us. God shall raise us.
Praise God.
My brother, you're going to believe it now. Heavenly Father, as I hold his hand, may the power of Almighty God come upon our brother, and may every frail doubt that's trying to hang on, be broken loose. Faith past that sound barrier. Long buzzing out through yonder in the kingdom of God, persistent, claiming his healing through the stripes of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Lord,
and this is, I believe this is the hour. I lay my faith with my sisters upon God's holy altar, with my prayers and my faith with hers. I ask God in the name of Jesus Christ to give her her blessings. Amen. So our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, may my prayer that I lay with my brothers, my hopes with his hope, my faith with his faith, upon your holy altar, receive it, Lord. I offer this in his behalf, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Be persistent now. Hold right on to it. God bless you, my brother. Our Heavenly Father, they said the prayer of faith saves the sick. I'll offer mine with my brother. I feel for him. Oh, Lord, I pray that you'll heal him. Hear us, Lord, as I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you, brother. Persistent now, believe me. I'm not sister. Our Heavenly Father, as I stand here in thy presence, and in the presence of this congregation, in the presence of this woman, I ask as I lay prayer with hers up on the altar, receive us, Father. I offer this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. God bless you. Be persistent now. Don't have it out. Come, sister. Would you like to go home and eat your supper? We make well. Just go away. Please, sister. Heavenly Father, I pray that you will heal her as I offer my prayer with hers in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Bless you, brother. Our Heavenly Father, I lay my hands upon brother. In the name of Jesus Christ, may he be healed. I offer my prayer with his Father for your holy altar. In Jesus' name, may he be healed. Amen. God bless you, brother. Now to the audience. Jesus said these words. Mark 11:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if you say to this mountain, be moved, and don't doubt in your heart, but believe that what you have said will come to pass, you can have what you say. Do you believe it?
Amen.
All right, and lay your hands on one another. Bow your heads. Lay your hands upon each other. Don't doubt. Now, if you say to this mountain, be moved. Lord Jesus. Now, while you're praying, I'm praying for a little lady, for a little boy. Father God, I pray that you'll grant the healing of the little boy. And I lay hands upon him and believe in Jesus' name that it shall be done. As I put my faith in his loved one here upon your altar, may he recover, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Please, sister, be persistent. I just don't know. Praying for the sick has been something I have never been able to understand. Before I ever went out with discernment or anything, somehow I just go pray for the sick when I was just a local Baptist minister down there. Somehow or another, they just got well. I don't know. Many of you have read the stories about even God sending the animals in, how people has come through dreams and revelations. People who never heard the force come from miles and across the sea be prayed for. I just pray a prayer of faith, all I know. And I believe it. I believe it. God promised it. And then if he promised that, now you don't have to take my word for it. You take his word for it. And then you'd have to take my word about him calling me to pray for the sick. But I think that he's proved that. Looky here, years ago when I told you about this great light pillar of fire, told you how it looked before any scientific picture was ever taken of it. Now look at the pictures they've got of it. Now that same light is standing right here where I am right now. I'm looking right straight at it. Right here. An emerald colored light. Now that mechanical eye, that camera, don't take psychology, you know. The light was there. Here it is doing just exactly what it said it would do. Jesus said, I come from God, and I go to God. A little while, the world won't see him no more, yet you'll see me. Now here, what was he? the pillar of fire that led the children to the wilderness. It was made flesh in the form of a man, Jesus Christ. He died, buried, rose up into heaven, and on the road to Damascus, Paul met the same pillar of fire. He said, oh, that's wrong. Oh, no. He said, Lord, who are you? He said, I'm Jesus. Now, none of the rest of them saw it. Paul saw it. Nobody else saw that dove but Jesus, over Jesus, but John, because he knew he was going to see it, because God told him so. That's it. He was persistent. He knew it. Now, here it is. Now, I prayed for each one of you. I prayed for each one. Jesus said, if you say to this mountain, be moved, and don't doubt in your heart, but believe that what you have said will come to pass, you can have what you say. Now, I have said it. Now, let it be done. It's written to be spoken. I have spoken, let it be done. Now let us pray with our hands on each other as believing children of God. You ever was persistent. How can you keep from being persistent now? If these mighty signs have been done in Russia, it wouldn't be communist today. These mighty signs have been done in China. It would be communist today. Oh, America, America. How often has God visited you? How much longer will He permit it? The evening time is here. The evening lights are shining. Now, Lord, I love these people. They are your people. And together we are brothers and sisters in your Son, Jesus. And now, Lord, as I spoke tonight of David with the little slingshot, he was interested in the Father's sheep. And no matter how little it was, he was ready to display and to conquer with what little he had to conquer with, and you was with him. Lord, I'm coming after these sheep tonight. They've been sick. I've obeyed your commandments. You showed your presence, your willingness. You've healed with card, without card, showing that you're here. You never fail. You're the omnipresent God. And I'm coming to challenge the devil that would keep them behind the sound barrier of unbelief.